Dr. Tien. Dr. Tien has received his Bachelor in Science and Chemistry at the National Chang-Hsing University in Taiwan. He obtained his PhD in polymer chemistry at the University of Southern Mississippi. Dr. Tien has published more than 100 articles, over 95 proceedings, edited 3 books and several books chapters, as well as 9 issues patent in several interdisciplinary research areas. He is co-inventor of the polymer stabilized liquid crystal display device and technology. His research is directed toward tailoring liquid crystal materials to provide control over structure, morphology, and processing in the development of new electro-optical devices. Dr. Chien and his research group are exploring a variety of approaches leading to the development of new electro-optical devices using liquid crystal template polymer composite with characteristic features in the 10 to 10,000 nanometer ranges. Today, he will lecture in optical isotropic liquid crystals for photonic and display applications. Thank you.
Good morning. Thanks for this opportunity to come down here, a beautiful city, beautiful country, and especially nice people here. It's my pleasure to talk about a little bit of this new liquid crystals applications, and that's actually on the web. You can see the research area in our group. We focus on materials, new materials, and then we use that for application and device. I will not go through this, but if you're interested in that, you can go to our webpage over here, and then you click on that, and you can find this information. For detailed information, you can see, just show you a little bit. We work on a different type of material, liquid crystal gratings, these are almost set like shadows, and then liquid crystal lens, and also some of this inkjet printing device application. In the device, we also work on multiple areas. We work on this bistable refractive displays, which full color has been demonstrated in recent years. And there's also interesting this electrically switchable these colors in polystyrene and blue phase liquid crystals. We also work on some of these nanoparticle doped liquid crystals and to enhance the speed of switching. So that's kind of interesting areas that everybody trying to use the nanoparticle to modulate the media. So I guess the other things I will not go into detail. The last things I want to advertise before we go to our lecture is that there's still 1 week to go. Since you are attending another week of this IPAM. The week after that, the June 19th, 20th, will be this Montpelier College, South heavily Massachusetts. If you're interested in learning more liquid crystals, feel free to submit your application, send it to me because of the application deadline is coming down. So since I'm the chair, I can authorize that your participation. And if there's a possibility, I will also try to rake up some funding to sort of purchase of the global travel. But that's the options you may have if you're interested in more of this liquid crystals. Okay, so I guess let's get started this topic on optical isotropic liquid crystals for photonics and display application. And this is the institute at Kent State. I think we also have 4 students here joining this summer school. The program is called Chemical Physics Interdisciplinary Program. It's a graduate program. We sponsor and support graduate students with outstanding graduates, and hopefully some of you can join us in the future. The program has multiple concentrations in optoelectronics, in physical property, in landscaping, in materials design and applications, and certainly there are some neuroscience, nanotechnology. So in this case, we have talked about this optical lens topic. I think mostly you know that liquid crystals, they are anisotropy, certainly they have this optical variance. But in this case, in the blue phase materials, it's kind of a highly twisted chiral materials. And in this chiral material from showfish, roughly around 0.2 micron, and then it twists into cubic lattice because of lack of symmetry. So I will go through that in this lecture 1 and 2, I go through this discovery history, and textual structure of that, the inference of electric field, cubic structure, such as restriction, field-induced variance, and then field-induced phase conditions, sometimes they don't go as smooth as you expected under the electric field modulation. So, certainly, I think there are a lot of these efforts recently to make this the surprise comeback. This blue phase materials come at age, comes as age, you know, it's been studied for numerous years, but I think the reason the ones have made this new material become an interesting topic. There are multiple methods, even that I just give you a couple of that. And then I show you some of the work that we're doing here in our laboratory. So as we say that the blue phase come of age, it means you know, the first discovery of liquid crystals comes from the plant. So our previous speakers, this Professor Arendt, is very gave a very good lectures on this nature products, on these nanofibers. Actually, first discovery of this polystyrene material is coming from this showing two melting points. It's coming from the plant. And then this Redis is the first one to discover that. But you know, during the discovery, while heating this and cooling down, it also is showing some kind of a bluish color. You know, so that was kind of a part of the discovery, but was not well documented. But later on, I think another group of people that we also working on that on materials. Sometimes this some of the dynamic phase, fractured the defect phase, you know, they are not very well understood because of all the materials point of view. But if you kind of spend some time investigating the physical properties of these materials, then you can find out more. In general, the discovery of these materials is due to the so narrow range of temperature between this isotropic and the cholesteric phase. This cholesteric phase is a kind of helical structures which are forming these showfish materials. Unfortunately, they have a very narrow temperature range. This material can exhibit blue phase, is mostly can be formed achieved by this optically active chironimetic material. That a liquid crystal material is shown the nematic, but because of this symmetry breaking with this chiral tails or this chiral structure building into the molecular structure. And then when they are showing this high pitch, highly twisted chiral with high chirality, cooling down from the isotropic, I can show this blue phase. And the other method is by mixing a pneumatic liquid crystal with one or more chiral tokens. That's the other method. The phase was classified into three categories depending on the double twist cylinder packing structure. For example, blue phase 1, polycentered cubic structure, and blue phase 2, the simple cubic structure. And then blue phase 3, some people call them a frog phase or isotropic phase, it's totally optically isotropic. So, in addition to that, they're useful to generate some kind of field-induced variance, it's called curve peg. and we can look into that. So the title of texture, you can see, quite a wide variety of plate-like. You can see a plate-like forming textures under the microscope on cooling in general. And then because of the domain size and the orientation, sometimes I can show multiple column break reflection. And then when you cool further down from the blue face, you can see that the cholesteric textures of this photocolloid start to establish. So sometimes the textures wise is quite unique. You cannot distinguish them. Though for blue face one crystalline, in general, you can see on cooling start to show these blue-like colors. These are blue plates, and then when you put the cooling down, then sometimes the blue face transform into blue face one. If you have a thick sample, okay, you will need to have a thick sample, and then on the refractive mode, you can see that pretty nice of this crystalline structure that shows this torso diagram, and we can discuss that a little bit later on. The cartoon shown here is those are highly twisted cylinders. They are double twisted cylinders, and then more or less like arranged in orthogonal structures. But the defect line are straight right-handed corners, and sometimes is the voice here, and they show these defects, and then it can form all kind of arrangement. So they are, in general, three type of faces, as we mentioned here. The blue face one is BCC. You know, from the theoretical point of view, the physical point of view, I think, how is this form? It can be expressed by this Landau theory for this cubic face. It was first proposed by Berdowski, and then Dimitri, and then also Honorice in the earlier 70s, and in the mid-70s and 80s. This Landau theories of DNA is the scale of quantity. It can be expanded in the lowest order of scale combination of the Q tensor. It's expressed like this. So this free energy can be expressed by a equation of that. We can take a look by breaking down. For that parameter A, it's more like temperature dependence. That temperature dependence in alpha is the test of this coefficient of constants. And then the coefficient of the B is of the chiral term. This is the chiral term here. This chiral is proportional to the chirality, so that means if you have a material that's highly chiral, and then it will show this blue face. The terms of this order Qn, so there's so many of Qn here, give us the first order of the pneumatic isotropic transition, and then this curve of this Q squared term here is represents the gradient of the Q necessary to produce a cubic structure. And then here in turn, the third one here is the chiral term, allowed because of the molecules themselves, the lack of symmetry. So it is this chiral term that which generally complicates the situation and cause the appearance of blue face. So from the physics point of view, I think that from the free energy of this little crystal packets, and you can see that the chirality induces the structures. Because of lack of mirror symmetry, this is one of the requirements, but this is an interesting property. In general, there are non-little crystal faces, like you can pneumatic faces, there's a pneumatic face, an isotropic. Temperature. The arrangement of that is certainly as a function of temperature from a crystalline state to isotropic temperature, and some of the representative textures, the Chilean textures of defects, and then these are photochronic fan textures of cinematic type, certainly cinematic A here as shown here. At the bottom here, the chiral liquid crystal phase consists of they may have in the case of snake A, a certain case of snake C, chiral C, the ferroelectric type of structure that this liquid crystal in the layer, they have a tilting with a degree proportional to the material property, and also the chirality of this liquid crystal molecules. But in the charismatic A, sometimes they form this frustrated faces. They can form into this distal grain boundary effect. It's the blocks of the smelly assembly, and sometimes they are twisted with the enemies. Depends on the chirality of this liquid crystal molecule. And then this picture is that shown in the previous lecture that cholesterolemic that with the pneumatic light of molecule in each layer, because of the physical interaction of these chiral centers of a molecule, either in the tail or in the ridge core. And then they can rotate these molecules with respect because of the the background interactions in the layers that force them to offset each other and then to minimize the energy. So in this case that if they rotate 360 degrees, they form a typical dish. And then here showing that all these strips, some of that typical blue phase materials and then shown, they can show this kind of tubularities as we just showed earlier. And certainly, when you're getting this chiral liquid crystal molecules towards the much higher temperature, they also show this isotropic structure. So, again, we want to take a look at why they are optically isotropic. In this case, actually, this Professor Southey of Institute of Kent State. Actually, when he was, in Germany, he already started this, but in 1969 he joined this, he already at Kent State University. He proposed some of these cubic lattice structures of this blue phase BCC1, blue phase 1 of this BCC lattice like arrangement of this double twisted helix. And then there's also using a different kind of expression in the 80s. There are two groups that show that the cubic lattice structure of blue phase material. And then if we take a look at those blue phase 1 and blue phase 2 and 5 blue phase 3 pictures, in the unit cells, you can see that in the regions that is that is in the defect centers, that is totally isotropic. But in some areas, it also shows the mimetic like behavior. In the blue phase 2, outside of this boxes is totally isotropic. I mean, outside of those double helix regions, they are totally isotropic. And those helix are formed by cholesteric materials. They show a simple cubic arrangement. And in the blue phase 3, it shows this cholesteric spheres forming a phase separate nucleic structures. So in the isotropic, it's a kind of a randomly disordered phase. The blue phase form faces in this single crystals as a function of temperature. Sometimes they can change the size and shape, and then also change the arrangement from blue phase 1 to blue phase 2. So the question is, how can we identify them? How can we distinguish them in terms of structure wise? One method is using the coastal diagram, using this Bragg refraction of this blue phase material because of the periodical dielectric materials that are arranged in two layers. And then so we can try to find twofold, threefold, or fourfold symmetry axis. So we can try to find them. For example, we can have BP1 and BP2 and BP3. So this is in earlier papers also reported by Flyers in 86. So First of all, when we try to look at this coastal diagram, we look for these coastal lines, okay? For example, just count the equivalent lines, the number of equivalent axes or planes for cubic symmetry. For example, 6, 4, 4, 4 axes means they have 6 faces, and then they have 12, at least 12 fold axes. All of these numbers are mirror indices. You can arrange that. And then also you can count this three or four axes. Well, in terms of this symmetry, there's a rotation axis of C4 or this C2 on the corner of A, and then C3 on the corner of this cubes. So for example, BP1, they have 12 equivalent lines. If you under the optical microscope, you are able to see those 12 lines distinctly. But in this case, you have to whirl the crystals larger and larger, and then using the thick sample. In the case of BP2, there are 6 equivalent lines, very distinct those lines you can see from this coastal diagram. So that's one way to identify the phase structure. So in general, the group phase one, you can have a different type of arrangement in this polycenter cubics. In this case, you can see identify those lines as we mentioned earlier. In the group phase two, certainly they are only a simple cubic. So simple cubic, you can see quite distinct lines and in the cross sections of those, it can be a little bit complicated, depends on how you grow the crystals. And then the temperature wise, the cycle is dependent on the temperatures. The local structure of group faces, certainly they are double twist. There's a twist tensor, you can use that twist tensor. And then it's a direct BP times this refractive index. And then overall, these tensors can be used to describe different kind of phases. For example, numeric phase, there's no real non-zero eigenvalue of these twisted tensors. But in the cholesteric, cholesteric is a one real non-zero eigenvalue of this tensor, twisted tensor. But in this group phase materials, they double twisted tubes, they're two real, non-zero eigenvalue of this twisted tensor. So in this way, you can also using these tensors to simulate structures. And it's been reported in Nature Force, this 1995 journal. So from the top views and then bottom views and then side views, we can see in general that group phase of 1 and 2 is a distinct voids. And these voids, they have to minimize the free energy to stabilize those. But in general, because of this the instability of those defects, cause them to have a very low narrow range of temperature. Group phase can also show a local somatic order. Sometimes not just cholesteric somatic group phase is also being reported. And there's an earlier one reported in Physical Review Letters showing that in group phase there's a somatic orders can form inside of the tube. And I think the group is Yamamoto with Yokoyama. There's our research associate, researcher professors at Kent State Institute. Also showing that in somatic phase, you can see from somatic A with high chiral of somatic A, actually chiral somatic A. And then depending on the concentration, okay, there are two types of liquid crystals being used to form that group phase somatic. This somatic group phase is one is the twin. One is the twin. You see that the chiral tails here. and then the tile tails here. And then with some flexible spaces in between. So this is a twin chiral messaging past one of it, another chiral messaging here that's showing the somatic phases. In general, they show the somatic A, chiral somatic A. And then the phase diagram, depending on the composition of these two, if they are increasing the second one, you can see that it only shows the chiral somatic A to isotropic. But if at the low concentration of the second one, so this one is highly efficient power, so that can give a shoulder pitch here. And you can see that it shows the TGB phase and the chiral somatic phase, and then it shows two different distinct chiral somatic blue phases. Blue phase is X1 and blue phase X3, showing that. But if the data this, for example, this mixtures of the second one is 70%, and then this phase, that's the other frostal phase and the magnetic phase disappear. That gives you a broader range of this somatic blue phase. The transition of blue phase 3 to isotropic, I can show a critical point. And sometimes this critical point means at some chiral fraction increase, this blue phase 3 is going, there's a kind of it's a biphasic region, a mixed phase region between the blue phase 3 and the isotropic. But in general, at the lower chiral concentration, you may only see it's cholesteric to its isotropic. Once you increase the chiral concentration, you can start to see the blue phase 1. And then in some cases, you can see the blue phase 2 also below that isotropic. And then blue phase 3 sometimes just directly showing between this blue phase 1 and blue phase 3. So the phase diagram is established, but it also is a materials property dependence. Let's take a few examples here. This has been published the paper. It's in the late 80s, mid-80s, the papers published using a pneumatic with three different types of chiral open. You can see that the first one is a binaxial derivative. This kind of binaxial derivative has a high heat of fusing power. And then R is right-handed, and all the other one, this one is commercially available. This one is R1011 from Merck. Merck has this material, the chiral synthesis. The other one, this one's SNS, means both of them they may have this same specific location of the chiral carbon here. But the tenderness is just enhanced by the this damping of this mesogenic light extension. In this case, they can form a different type of structure. They can form blue phase 1, blue phase 2, blue phase 3. So there's also way to use an optical methods to identify the blue phase of structures. So for example, blue phase 1 is designated as this in the case of a phase diagram, in the first case using binaxial chiral dopants versus plastic pneumatic. The theoretical diagram from the prediction, they can say depends on the helical pitch. So here is the increase in chiral concentration, and then this is the temperatures on the y-axis. So the cholesteric phase will form and then go to the isotropic at the low chiral concentration. Once you increase the chiral concentration, they expect to show the blue phase 1 and blue phase 2, and then some area blue phase 3. But experimentally, the results show that the phase diagram is likely changed proportional to this, compared to the theoretical models, but still capable to show that three different phases if you have the right concentration. So this here is so in this case, it's more like an induced blue phase material using the carbon plus a magnetic. So one of the properties of this fractal reflection is the fractal lens can be described as a function of depends on the angles of this measurement, and then also is the index of the materials. The X-ray select rules on this the Millet indices plan for cubic crystal. For example, there's in the case of a single cubic for blue phase 2, there's no restriction, but blue phase 1, this sum of those Millet indices must be even for phase center cubic, it's a Millet indices of this HKL must be all even at the same time, all are at the same time. So here is just the refractive wavelength as a function of temperature. You can see that in most cases, the blue phase material has a tendency of this either the red shift or this blue shift. Okay, in this case, that the temperature increase, the refractive wavelength is slightly is a blue shift. But if you have a materials that direct anisotropy is a negative. In that case, that it can have the opposite effect, it becomes a red shift. So that's the optical selection rules. This is the previous set. I have missed this slide to be put in a previous order. It shows that there's a tensor order parameter that you can use. And then you can use this Fourier expansion to establish that is the tensors. So in the case of a different kind of phases, the blue phase is a blue phase of 2, blue phase 1, and blue phase 3. They have a different kind of combination of those. So I will not go through those details, but in general, there's a possibility of using this optical selection rule, and this is very established by the home light and then also this fragment. So temperature dependence of vehicle pitch in some cases you can see that it shows that a great shift in the refractive wavelength, but on one of the material you can see that this is kind of a biaxial derivative. But in this case, with two parallel centers here in the center, this material shows this the opposite of the blue shift. For this one parallel centers, this R1011 or S1011 from Earth, you can see that this material is less temperature dependent of refractive wavelength. Change all the physical pitch. So in general, the materials could be selected either less temperature dependent, depending on the concentration, also all the type of materials. So there are two different type possibility to have a very base the extension of the degree of is a temperature, physical pitch change as a function of the temperature. But if you want to minimize this physical pitch change as a function of temperature, the best way is to use multiple carotopes. In this case, you can compensate each other thermodynamically, and then therefore that one goes to blue shift and the other one goes to the red shift. And you can compromise those by achieving either single component or multiple components. That means this one and that one, you may achieve this kind of temperature independence of the physical pitch. Why do we want this, you may want to ask the question, right? Why do you need this? If you're interested in some of device application, you know, you certainly don't want to have some power reflection in this field-induced variance. Otherwise, the residual variance or this color change might cause some problem in your device application. There's a field-induced phase change. Sometimes materials, in this case, if you have it's a SA11. SA11 is a it's this one. This commercially available is from Merck. And then you use one of these pneumatic materials, and this is published in by Hector's group. It's Professor Hector has retired 4 years from Technische University Berlin. This is published in 1989. You can see that on the y-axis is the applied field strength, the magnitude of the fields, and then on the x-axis is plotted as a function of the temperature. From the isotropic to group phase 2, group phase 1, and cholesterol. Okay? When you apply the electric field increasing from low 0 to high, it sometimes may do not go to this field-induced variance in terms of realigning of those molecules in the directional field. Instead, they change from one phase structure to the other. In the same group phase one, as we just see, we just saw in this this coastal diagram picture, they can rearrange a little bit in the group phase two too. But sometimes it also possible like a change from a group phase one to cholesteric. You see that if you follow this line, right, and you start to increase this electric field up to some stage, okay. You will kind of a little bit unwinding of those helical structure, and then it goes to the cholesteric. So this is also possible. But this is mostly unwinding because of if you turn the beam off, it doesn't go back to the root phase anymore. It stays. It's more like stabilized by this electric field and stays in cholesteric. So that's kind of that's kind of interesting phenomenon that sometimes if you have a particular type of material, this curve may be more the slope may be a little bit maybe a little bit smaller than this stiff one. So you can see that very easily you will change from one phase to the others to the cholesteric. And so this kind of phenomenon here, this phase change in group phase, it occurs quite frequently. But we say earlier that the break reflective wavelengths of blue phase depends on the materials. So sometimes a blue phase material depends on the chiral concentration in this mixture. It can have a much lower and the short wavelengths, for example, in blue phase one. And if you apply electric fields at in blue phase one, sometimes they have less tendency to change this refractive wavelengths. But when you have a little bit longer wavelengths, a longer pitch, you can see that the pitch roughly around 0.3 in this case. So you can see that at the different kind of temperature range, once you apply electric field, you put this cubic little crystals in the top down electrode in the cell, little crystal cell with two conductive plates. You apply electric field across the cell gap, and then you can see that there's a tendency of change. Okay, but this change is not that much, maybe 30 nanometers in terms of a rate shift. In break reflective wavelengths in the case of blue phase 2. So sometimes this material is more significant as a function of applied field change, but that also as a function of temperature dependence, when this helical pitch is more temperature dependent, you can see they shift from one wavelength to the others, from the short wavelength to long wavelength. They all have the similar tendency of grade shift in responding to this applied electric field. Certainly, the applied electric field is pretty high, roughly around 2-3 volts per micron. So, as we mentioned earlier, right, this blue phase material is quite interesting, and but because of their narrow phase range, it's kind of limit their usage for application. So the widening of this blue phase range has been a subject of intensive studies in the last 30 years and since the discovery. One of the interesting approach is since there's a possibility of using biomethogenic chiral material to induce chiral phases. So this biomethogenic pneumatic materials is reported by the Cambridge group and using it's a Southampton group using this fluorinated messaging on one side and then fluorinated messaging on the other side. So this material is some mixtures you can form room temperature pneumatic and with a chiral dopant, which is kind of solvable like this chiral material, very similar to the cellulose derivative. So this material with the appropriate concentration doping, for example, exceeded to one critical concentration, and you can see that this phase sequence of isotropic to blue phase 3, possibly forming blue phase 3, and then also possibly forming the blue phase 2, and then blue phase 1. And this material kind of delivered the blue phase up to the room temperature, and here shown a schematic phase. And then in some cases with the higher spatial group here, you can show a glass transition. Well, this material is interesting. It can show multiple behaviors. It uses a mixture of primary pneumatic and also chiral. It can show this spectroelectric effect. It can show field induced phase change and also field induced curve effect. So that's one approach. The other one, this type of mouth is application of this field induced fringes, and that's so called this curve effect. The reflect index of this N versus the direction isotropy, that's one important parameters we need to consider. Decrease or increase for mixtures with positive negative direction isotropy may change the curve constant. Certainly, with larger absolute direction isotropy, the material with large direction isotropy, then you can induce a large curve effect. And in this case, that you can achieve a larger variance in responding to applied field. So this variance is a function of this wavelength, this selective reflective wavelength, a product of this selective reflective wavelength and the curve constant and applied field square. In general, the curve constant is about 2 to 4 times a 10 to the minus 12, sorry, that minus 12 is meters of row squares. In that case, that depends on the cell configuration device. For this fields that are using implant electric fields induced, it also needs to consider the cell gap and also the electrical space and line. In terms of effective electric fields applied across the material. The response time of that material is governed by the rotational viscosity and then the helical pitch of the material, and certainly that the elastic constant of the material is very important. There's intermeasurability tensors, for example, this E plus equal to epsilon naught, and times this epsilon. This eta tensors can be expressed like this. It depends on that applied fields and this so-called Parker coefficient and plus this curve constant and the function of this applied field. This phi field certainly is proportional to the function of this curve constant and the wavelength. So if we neglect the bilaterality, assume the constant value of this average index of refraction, then this equation can be inferred. This dimension can be kind of simplified by that. So that's kind of a relationship. So to achieve this field-induced variance, you certainly need an electro-optic cell. In this case, that the electro-optic cell, the upper substrate, does not have any electrodes and conductive electrodes. But on the bottom substrates, it has this kind of a finger-like interdigitated electro patterns. And so you have this electro width, electro line width, and then also the space within that has been optimized. So how to make that is if you have a glass substrate and you have ideal electrodes, you print a spin cone and other photoresist layers, and then you use the photo mask to make a pattern of the electrodes. You shine a light, and then you remove those photoresist. You take out the photo mask, you develop. And then you use etch solution, you remove those ideal electrodes unwanted. And then you let the patterns of electrodes on the surface, and that's the kind of image of the patterns that you get. Then to control the cell again, we have to spray the spacers. You put type substrates on top of that. So in this case, now you're done with the cell assembly. So that's a kind of a normal picture of the cell assembly, and then the cell structure like this. Well, this device configurations, it can vary. For lab studies, kind of a straight electro line is fine. But I can show you a few microscope image later on. You can see that there are some kind of the discrimination line or the zero electric field on top of the electrode. In commercial application, you may want to use the zigzag electrodes. So tomorrow I show you that on the other type of implant switching device that's been commercialized using the PV. The field induced variance on the y-axis, and then here is the apply the field strength. So in this case, the applied field, if you plot them, and you can find out the slope. The slope is showing the sum of this equal to the curve constant. So in general, the curve constant is in the range of 10 to minus 9 to 10 to minus 11, depends on material. The blue phase material is curve constant larger than 10 to minus 9 can dramatically reduce the switching voltage of a DTLC device. And so that's kind of a field induced variance. So the other effort is using the composite materials, composite using polymer stabilized device. You can see that they can use a monomer and then a compositional monomer like EHA and a linear one, monofunctional, monopolymerizable group, and the ion reactive monomers from Merck. This Merck material has a mesogenic group and a spacer between two polymerizable groups. This polymerizable group are acrylate type, once you mix this with liquid crystals, a mixture of liquid crystals, and then a paradopant, two paradopants, actually, there's two paradopants here. One is 5CB, one is ZOI 4572, and here is the pneumatic, interfoiling of the pneumatic. So once you take these two together, you can see it depends on how much of polymerized monomer in this mixtures of blue phase. You can see that either start in this study shows that 6.3, 10.5, and then 15.0. That's so the more polymer medium and then low polymer concentration, you can see that the response time of this material, it kind of with more polymer, it can lower to roughly around this 100 microseconds at the room temperature. But with the less polymer, if it is a stabilization effect or this this interaction of polymer network in the box with little crystal reorientation, it kind of has lower this modulus. And then this one has a higher polymer, has higher modulus, and that stored energy is higher. So in the case of this decay, this rise is by the electric field and then decay. So it goes, this fast response, here is 20, roughly around 18 microseconds in the turn off time, once you turn the field off. And then at the low concentration, it takes a longer time to relax back to its original state. So you can see that with polymer stabilization, I think the next slide, the temperature range depends on the concentration. They have a different type of composition here, from the mole percent. This one is reported in Nature Materials. In general, up to a limit of about 8% of polymer networks inside of the composite material, it can reach to roughly around 60 degrees, so roughly around 60 degrees K, including the room temperature. The electron restriction size slightly larger than 100 microseconds at room temperature. Certainly, at higher temperature, the rotational viscosity is low. Okay, so it is because of this recent surprise. We will start right here, okay? We'll start at this slide. It's because of this recent surprise. There's a Samsung demonstrate one of these panels at the conference, Society Information Display conference in 2008. The idea is you have this optically isotropic materials. You can switch at the off state. You can see there's a perfectly dark. In the on state, when you apply electric fields across this interdistate electrode, you can induce this variance in the direction parallel to the applied field direction. And if you have this cross horizon line up in the direction with this orientation positioned at the 45 degree with respect to cross horizons in at 90 degrees. So in that case, you get a bright state, you get all light passing through, you get a dark state. So this is very nice device because of the merits of those devices with alignment free. This type of cubic material doesn't need for alignment in the very beginning. It's implant switching and fast turnaround time, high contrast widening angle, because you see that it's a perfect dark state. And then this implant rotation device giving the symmetric retardation in all direction, so you don't have any residual. Unfortunately, since we have a polymer network composite with liquid crystal, there are some limits. So possibly they're thinking about the production plan for 2015. For that device with further improvements in materials, because the limits include high switching voltage, hysteresis of electrophoric response, light scattering, temperature range wise is also a need. There's a need for further improvements. In addition to that, because of this auto-induced convolution, there's a long-term stability issues we need to consider. Because of this, lots of ions, free radicals, to increase the direct constants. So, this both in protein ratio and in the active matrix driving methods, there's also capacitors under each pixel. Once you apply the electric field, sometimes they need to hold the image for a while, but if the dielectric constants increase with the almost stabilization, you will have a light leakage, you will have this electric leakage. So your pixels are unable to hold up the retardation values that you switch the molecule to the position. And then so your contrast will be distorted. So there's a kind of poor contrast in that case. So I guess we stop right here for a quick break. And if you have any questions, feel free to.
I think so. We can ask some questions now, and then you can continue with the second lecture so we don't are too far from schedule.
Could you go back to the diagram of the implant switch really quickly?
The diagram?
The schematic image. Should be about 5 slides back. No, down.
A little bit down?
Yeah. Might be farther down than that. Whichever one shows the structure of the implant switching cells.
Oh, I see. Maybe?
It's down one more, I believe, from there. Maybe one more. There's one that said there was ITO on the top surface of the glass. I was wondering what the reason was for that.
Oh, this one is IPO substrate that we just flip over. I still put IPO on the top. So you don't need to, sometimes you try to etch the surface of IPO, it's impossible to complete. So you kind of leave your eyes on it. But I think you can use you can use a no IPO coated glass to make that. In general, the size of the crystals is roughly around from 100 micrometers size to several hundred. Okay, normally less than a millimeter. Yeah. You know, so if you like to grow a millimeter size, this crystal, it really takes very low cooling rate. Okay, so that the nucleation process takes place by itself slowly. That's the one of the techniques. And uniformly, on top and bottom substrates, you probably the hostage you need to have very good control in terms of temperature gradients. That's also a good question. With IPO only versus with polyimide coating, polyimide rounded polyimide, or vertical aligned polyimide, the crystal size slightly different.
Yeah.
Yes, and also the formation of the orientation is also different. Sometimes you can have only one type of crystal. Okay. If you really control that. So we try a different type of surface alignment, planar alignment, hybrid alignment, top-down. One is planar, one is homotropic, and two homotropic. For most material with strong anchoring, you can orient crystals in much better shape and size. But in addition to that, sometimes you have to stabilize those defects. So I think in the next lecture, the rest of that picture, this presentation, I can show you some of the work that we've done with nanoparticle doping and some other material, maybe peptides doping. Okay.
Okay, if there's no further questions, we can continue with the second lecture. I'm sorry.
Different.
Okay.